programs. She has also authored several international papers. That's really great. Thank you so much for being with us. We also have today Mr. Samil Nair. He is currently working as a senior consultant at Mercer Wealth Practice. He has over 20 years of experience in life insurance, banking, and pension consulting. He is an expert in client management and business sourcing management, expert in fund manager evaluation and program management. Welcome, Mr. Nair. We have Mr. Mono Phukon. He is presently working as general manager with PFRDA, and his current assignments are promotion and development of NPS, product design, training, media and public relations, financial literacy, board secretariat, information help deck, and pension advisory committee. Prior to joining PFRDA, he worked with IDBI Bank as deputy general manager and with Corporation Bank as product manager, and his banking experience of more than 12 years. He holds an honorary degree in commerce, MBA, and CAIIB. Welcome, Mr. Phukon. Now, I also introduce Ms. Kamding. She is currently the partner at Deloitte Haskin and Sells LLP. She has over 25 years of work experience in corporate and international tax to companies with focus on financial services and technology sector. She has advised Indian financial institutions on the Indian tax laws and rules implementation and US tax law, Foreign Account Tax Compliance Act, and the OECD, the Common Reporting Standards. And then we have from CIA, Mr. Manish Gupta. He's the Vice Chairman of CIA Chandigarh Council. He started his own unit in 2000 and pursued his passion of doing R&D and manufacturing for the Defense Forces. That's his great specialty. Having passion for education, Mr. Manish has completed his MBA along with starting his entrepreneurship venture. He's an active executive member of the Aeronautical Society of India. He is the recipient of Award of Excellence in Indigenization from the Ministry of Defense, as well as from the Society of Indian Aerospace Technologies and Industries. Now, with this, I would like to start the session, and I would like to request Mr. Bandyopadhyay to please start his presentation. And thank you so much, sir, for being with us today afternoon.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Dr. Grewal. Thank you for such a nice introduction. And Mr. Manish Gupta, Vice Chairman CII Chandigarh, and other people from CII, and my co-panelists. First of all, my thanks goes out to CII for arranging this session today. I believe this is our first interaction with CII, where CII and PFRDA together is taking this effort to make NPS more popular. We already had some sessions with the Indian Chamber of Commerce and FICCI, and those were also accepted well. And with CII coming in, I believe it will go a long, long way in really making people aware about NPS, the benefits of NPS, and the benefits of having a retirement scheme. That having said, I want to just give you certain facts about the demographics, about the Indian retirement scenario, where it is now, what people are thinking, what NPS is trying to do, and how far we have been successful in our effort in last few years. You know that India's population is growing at a rate where it seems that by 2027, we are going to overtake China. We are going to become the most populous country in the world. And this is an obviously irreversible fact that as we see today, it is going to happen in next 6 years' time. So most of us will be there to see that. Secondly, not only India population is going up, Indian population is going up, we are aging and aging at a very fast rate. Today, when this vaccination process is going on in the country, we know that the frontline workers, medical workers have completed the next group, which is contemplated to be vaccinated on priority basis, is 50 plus. What is the number like? We know for certain 60 plus, the total number in India is close to 13.5-14 crore. And if you take 50 plus, it will be closer to 30 crore. So we are looking at a mass of 30 crore people who are 50 plus. What is happening in the Indian retirement scenario is that most of the people, they defer their decision to go for a pension scheme or accumulating something for their future life at a pretty late age. Maybe it is late 40s or early 50s. Just a small incident. Last time when we are having a session with the ICC, in the question answer session, one gentleman asked a question. And that gives some idea as to where we are in so far as retirement contribution and retirement corpus building is concerned. His question was that I have 10 years to go. Today is 21. I am retiring in 2031. I need 40,000 rupees per month as pension. And today my total corpus is 10 lakh. So what do you think, how much do we need to save? We made a rough back of the envelope kind of calculation. We found that at the current annuity rate, if it is 6%, he needs a corpus of 80 lakh by 2031. And that means by a simple calculation, another 70 lakh to be created over next 10 years. This is fact. And this is what is happening in most of the cases. And when we go and talk to younger generation, they feel that the retirement is for somebody else. It is not for me. I have another 30, 35 years to go. I have enough time. What they forget is that if you lose those valuable 5, 6, 7, 10 years at the initial phase of your life, maybe you have to lot of savings to do to finally meet your goal. And really, I do not know, maybe Preeti, when she talks, she can throw some light on that. Today, sitting here today, I do not know really what my goal should be in 2031. I cannot predict what is going to be the inflation rate. What are going to be my expenses? People feel with retirement, maybe my entire life pattern, expense patterns will undergo a change. It does not happen. Lot of things remain constant and lot of things actually go up. Like as we have seen during this lockdown phase also, medical expenses have gone up. And even though people are living much, much longer today, what is happening post 60, we see medical expenses are going up at a much, much faster rate than what we see before 60. Secondly, the medical expenses, if you look at the inflation and you put it in two groups, medical cost inflation and other cost inflation. Medical cost inflation at any given time is almost 2.5 to 3 times of the normal cost inflation. So these are certain things to be taken into account, and we have to maybe start investing or saving something now to create really a good corpus to meet our goals. Longevity is a big risk. Today, the longevity risk is so high, anybody reaching 60, unless they are properly protected, there is every chance that person will outlive the corpus that he or she has created. On an average, at the age of 60, we Indians are living for another 17 to 18 years. This is again another fact. And as the medical science advances more and more, we'll find that this average age, average life after 60 years of age is going up drastically. Today in Japan, I had been to Tokyo last year, I have seen their statistics and the way they are managing it. It's very painful because there, on an average, a male person at the age of 60 is living for another 27 years. And a female is living for another 29 years. So see, that 27, 29 years, that is a long time. And unless you have proper corpus and regular income to lead a dignified life becomes very, very difficult. What is the pension sector scenario today in India? It's very fragmented. Many players are there who are giving pension. But there are only few players who are really focused on pension as a subject. I'm thankful Dr. Grewal pointed it out that NPS was created, PFRD was created with a focus to give pension. Technically, if you look at it, EPFO also gives a pension because there is a EPS content. But how much is that pension like? We have calculated maybe in the best case scenario, it will be around 7,500 rupees a month. Is that enough? Obviously, the answer is no. What happens to the EPFO corpus, that provident fund corpus? We don't know really, because there is no compulsion on a provident fund contributor that you have to necessarily take a pension with that corpus. So I can technically spend that amount any way we like. And that is exactly what is happening. Apart from superannuation funds being managed by insurance companies, where there is a compulsory annuitization and NPS, there is no other scheme which is really looking to give you a retirement corpus or generate a retirement corpus. You can access those funds at any given point of time. Any amount you want to access, you can access that. And in many cases, we see that those funds are really spent well before one reaches that superannuation stage. NPS started in the year 2004, and it started with central government employees, because government also found that the old pension scheme, which gives a defined replacement ratio of 50% without any funding concept, of course, that was very, very difficult to manage financially, obviously. And a lot of committees were formed, and ultimately from 2004 January, central government decided whichever new central government employee is recruited post this date, they have to necessarily go into NPS, which is a defined contribution scheme. It was a big change. Earlier one was a defined benefit, where the benefit is defined without any connection to the funding. Even if there is no funding, as you go out of employment, you will continue to get 50% of your last month pay. This defined contribution scheme, you come here, you join. It may be a voluntary, it may be a mandatory, as it happened in case of central government employees post 2004. And you start contributing. It will be invested in the market. We manage our funds in a mark-to-market kind of a situation, the way mutual funds are managed. We try to see that, yes, we take market risk. Whenever you are investing in market, market risk is part and parcel of that. But at the same time, this being a retirement fund, we try to see that safety is the first motto of fund managers. Even if you are taking almost 75% into equity, if some subscriber wants that, but we try to put in the best quality, maybe Nifty 50 and beyond that, hardly 60, 70, very well chosen, well researched stocks. If you are putting in corporate bonds, almost as I see today, more than 90 to 95% is in AAA rated corporate bonds, where the chances of defaults are less. If we do in government security also, we see that we have a duration which gives, under the current interest rate scenario, the best kind of returns. So that way, there is a presentation by Mr. Mona Foucault at a later point. You will see the kind of returns that you have generated by taking safety as the first motto. We have not given away return. We have not forgotten return. Return is also there. So we have grown, and we have grown from scratch. We started in 2008. Actually, the fund started coming from 2008. And today, we are very happy to say that we have crossed 5.5 trillion rupees. That is the total fund under management. Though a large part, almost 80%, belongs to central and state government employees. But slowly, of late, we have seen that Indian corporates are also coming and joining in big numbers. And these are basically, we have seen central public sector enterprises, those who have their privately managed superannuation funds, they are joining en masse because they see that this is a better, having a better tax benefit, as Dr. Grewal has rightly pointed out, and it has lesser cost and better return. So all taken together, they also feel that this is a better way of giving benefit to our superannuation fund members. Lot of corporates joined voluntarily also, and there are in few corporates we have seen employers also contributing, but in most of the corporates, private corporates, only employees are contributing. More than 8,100 corporates are already joined, but the total number as we see is not even 11 lakh, which shows that yes, that corporate has already started its relationship with NPS, but only few employees, they have really taken steps to join. So there our request through this forum, I believe a lot of your participants today will be corporates, is that the management, the HR and the senior people, they are also have to play a role in the sense that they have to really guide their employees. Yes, this is required. And this is not required today, but this is required for tomorrow. You start contributing from today. And as you go along, as you grow in the organization, as you have a better cash flow in hand, you may contribute little more. That's why we have kept a lot of flexibility in the system, in the NPS system. If you look at, by contributing even 1,000 rupees a year, you can keep your account running. In a difficult time, difficult year, you feel that you cannot contribute whatever you have been contributing earlier years. No hard and fast rule. Unlike many other schemes where you have a fixed commitment, here there is no fixed commitment. You can increase it, you can decrease it also to the extent of 1,000 rupees a year. So far as the higher limit is concerned, absolutely there is no higher limit. Obviously, whatever you contribute has to be supported by your known sources of income. I need not say that. But apart from that, there is no higher limit in the contribution. So that gives a lot of flexibility to people. According to their choice, they can contribute. If you are not happy with a particular fund manager, we are currently 7. If you are not happy with a fund manager, you can change your fund manager once a year. You change it. Our returns are available in the websites. Anybody can go and check and they can change. If you are not happy with the investment pattern today, you feel that I have missed the rally in the equity market, I was more debt oriented, you can change it. And that also you can change twice a year. So a lot of flexibility, and it comes at a pretty low cost. Dr. Grewal has already pointed out we have possibly one shortcoming is that the intermediary fees and especially the distribution channel. Yes, we are looking into that. But Dr. Grewal also will agree we are working on a thin line that what maximum benefit can be given to the customers and what maximum benefit can be given to the intermediaries. Yes, definitely we'll have a relook on that. Wherever possible, we'll have a, definitely have a relook. Recently, we had a new pension fund manager, RFP. There we are proposing much higher fund management charges. Earlier, even our fund management charge was 1 paise. For every 100 rupee you give, I charge you 1 paise. For the kind of returns that we have given, our equity, our fixed income, either government security or corporate bond, equity is above 11% kind of return we have given. And that is not for 1 year, a track record of almost 11 years. So for 1 paise, fund management charge for every 100 rupee you give, we are giving this kind of return. So that means the intention of the fund managers are very clear. Despite this kind of a fund management charge, we'll give our best. So with support of everybody, our pension fund is growing, but possibly the growth can be even more. Looking at the ticking time bomb, people are aging. lot of people are in the young age group who can still start contributing. I believe there is a huge scope. I believe Preeti will be talking on it, Preeti and Sunil, because they are experts. They have given advices to many clients. And about the taxation part, our taxation expert, Madam Kamdeen, is there. She will be also talking. So thank you so much, CII, for giving us this platform. And thank you all co-participants, co-speakers, for joining us. And I believe it will be a very, very entertaining kind of exposition that we have today. And post that, we are ready for all the questions that your participants want to have. Thank you so much, Dr. Kamdeen.
Thank you so much, sir, for touching briefly on the major aspects of the pension fund and encouraging the corporates to be more actively participating with it. And we now move on to our next speakers, Preeti and Sunil Nair, and they'll be sharing their views on the retirement benefits planning. Over to you, Preeti ji.
Thanks a lot. A very, very good afternoon to all of you, and wishing all of you a happy new year. We're still in January, so I think we can still wish a new year to all of us. I would at the outset like to thank PFRDA and the CII Chandigarh chapter for giving us this opportunity to speak upon something which is a big focus area for my organization, Mercer, as well as for myself in person. So what we will be talking about in our session is largely on three aspects. If we can move on to the next slide, please. The three dimensions we'll be covering is we definitely will longer live longer, and PFRD chairman also touched upon statistics, which was indeed startling for us, that we are talking about increasing population overtaking China in terms of the numbers, but also increase in the aging population, which is definitely something that all of us at least should be thinking about. I will not say worry about. We need to plan for it so that we worry less, but definitely we need to think about it. The second aspect we will be talking about is how do you de-stress financial distress at the workplace? Because our focus is going to be largely the corporate NPS program, and we will draw insights from some of the experiences we have had with helping organizations implement NPS. So if we move on to the next slide. Yeah, so this is the first portion. Clearly, aging is not something which is very, very new to India, or it is not something which is very typical to India. We are seeing most countries around the world are actually looking at aging population because of advancement in medical science. We see the population, people living longer, but would they be living healthier is a question that we need to ask. Clearly, that coupled with aspects on where how the markets are behaving, you've had low returns, low growth, corporates are moving from defined benefit kind of a regime to defined contribution. So clearly the onus on individuals gets higher. And this is a topic which is too important for us to ignore at all. If you move on to the next slide, I will talk about two key studies which Mercer actively participates in every year. The first one is the Mercer CFA Institute Global Pension Index, of which I have given some statistics here. These are statistics for 2020. We have had 39 countries participating. India was ranking 34. We don't need to be too harsh on ourselves on this, because honestly, we don't have a social security system which is sponsored by the government, and hence we would be lower. However, having said that, there are certain areas where we can actually do better. The first one is there is very, very low coverage on private pension in India. We just have about 6% coverage in India on private pension, which is something that honestly, we need to really think about. Can all of us as corporates or as responsible citizens do something different for us to be able to up that 6% to something better? The second one is that we have easy access to money of retirement pretty much early on. So it in some sense erodes the retirement corpus, and these are the two main reasons why we are seeing India actually ranking below some of the other countries. So just for the information of the audience, in case you're interested, the ones just above us are Japan and China, and the ones just below us are actually Mexico and Philippines. And the key difference between us and Japan and China is the easy access we have to the retirement corpus before we reach retirement, and hence it erodes or reduces the level of adequacy of the retirement corpus to be able to give us a sustainable pension income. If you move on to the next slide, please. Now, this is the second dimension. Can we afford longevity? Again, this is based on a study with the World Economic Forum, where we see something called the retirement savings gap. And here again, China and India are the highest. Multiple reasons for this. We are having a rapidly aging population. We are having over 90% of the total workforce in the unorganized sector in India. And then there's also this growing middle class, where there's an improvement in the quality of life, and money is never enough. So clearly, when we reach retirement, the money that we have actually accumulated and have translated into retirement income is clearly not enough. And hence, we see a big gap between the retirement savings and the requirement of money towards retirement. So let us look at what's happening in life over here in India. If you move on to the next slide, please. What's happening here? And we talked about expenses like medical inflation, et cetera, increasing. But clearly, while we are working, we have all these forces acting on the salary it's like cash outflows. We have household expenses, regular payments, food expenses, transportation, entertainment, personal expenses like children care, et cetera, health and medical expenses, et cetera. And after we take care of all these expenses, then the turn is that of savings. This is typically what happens to most people, it is a younger age group that is like a 20, 25, 30. This is typically the scenario in their homes, because you need to buy that fancy car, you need to buy the big apartment, then you have the EMIs, etc., which eat onto your salary. Whatever is left is what you're looking at in savings. If we are not smart enough to be able to manage our expenses properly, if you move on to the next slide, we will see what happens. What is happening over here is that my post-retirement, my salary is not there. Salary gets replaced by retirement income, post-retirement income. However, as Chairman Sir just pointed out, that the medical expenses are almost 2.5 times that of any other expense as a benchmark. Plus, when post-retirement, most of us do not have any kind of a health coverage from our employer or ex-employer or any kind of social security healthcare. So we are pretty much dependent upon our own savings to be able to look after our healthcare needs. So it's like a double whammy. You don't have enough savings, okay? And your retirement income is perhaps just hovering about 30 to 40% of your pre-retirement income, plus your medical expenses get that high. So this is something really, really important for us to understand while we are thinking that, right now my salary is, let's say, hypothetically, let's say 5 lakhs. Maybe if I get like 4 lakhs, 3 lakhs, 2 lakhs, it should be good enough, because I may not have so much of transport expenses. I may not have so many other personal expenses. My children would have finished their schooling, etc. Because the medical expense is something that most of us find very, very difficult to actually model and estimate for ourselves. If we move on to the next slide. So next thing that comes to our mind is, I have gratuity, I have provident fund, and maybe I was sensible enough to start with an NPS account very early. But what has happened? Don't you think that's enough? I mean, I will get a good amount of money to be able to get a post-retirement income. But guess what? Just do a very simple math. What is the right level of income replacement you should have, which is neither too large or too low? You would typically expect about 70 to 80%. But if you just look at provident fund and gratuity on very simple assumptions, and all of you can do the math at your end, the replacement is just about 25 to 30%. And if you have corporate NPS with 10% contribution right now, as we look at things, it could be just 33 to 40%. So clearly, you know, you need to do something much more than just look at what is my tax exemption and to contribute to NPS only to that extent. Can we look at something different then? Can we change our expense or spending pattern and skew more towards a saving kind of a scenario? If you move on to the next slide. Now we move on to another set of insights that we have seen from Mercer's own survey that we do periodically. So this is extracted from something which we call as a global talent trend survey. It actually surveys CXOs, it surveys employers, HR leaders, as well as employees. And what we have seen here is that clearly employees prefer to work, if you just look at the top, employees prefer to work for an organization that is known for, of course, stakeholder equally. And look at the second point, physical, physiological, and financial well-being. Clearly, employers are looking up to employees, employees are looking up to employers who actually take care about the financial well-being of the employees. Look at the left bottom. Most of us are expecting a stagnation of wage, especially the in next few couple of years till such time that we are able to emerge out of the COVID situation. Everything that you talk about here in terms of what is important to employees relates to savings, investment, help in wealth building, help in financial wellness. You look at how many times financial wellness or aspects relating to savings, investments have featured in all that are there. Look at the right side. With all this, yet we see very few organizations, as low as 29%, offer some kind of financial education or some kind of financial support to employees to be able to understand the level of financial well-being. So that is an interesting thing for us to see. I mean, are corporates really doing enough? If you move on to the next slide, look at the employee's perspective again. Why do they join, stay, or leave? Everywhere, again, we are talking about financial well-being initiatives, pension, retirement options. So clearly, joining, they are low on priority, but for them to stay, they go a couple of notches higher. And when they leave, they look at some other organization because they're better off in terms of supporting and financial well-being and pension retirement options to employees. We move on to the next slide. So what are we seeing here in organizations? We are clearly seeing that many people, especially in the private sector, are intending to work past retirement. So are we giving them enough flexibility? That's the first point. And second is, of course, on the career side, are you really supporting the older workers in terms of career support? So there are a lot of things you need to do for employees, for you to make things more flexible for them in terms of when they want to retire, when do they retire, at what point in time do they retire, and after that, what is the retirement talking about? Is it full retirement? Is it partial retirement, etc.? So with this, I will now hand over to Sunil, who will talk about what we have. So what we've talked about is why, in terms of what some macro parameters, what we are seeing in organizations in terms of focus of financial wellness. Now, Sunil will give you more insights and actually on the ground, real war stories in terms of what we have seen when we talk to organizations about NPS. Over to you, Sunil.
Thank you, Priti. Greetings to everyone. Coming on the slide. So we would like to share some thoughts of our clients and their employees on retirement benefit and planning. So this slide gives an employee-employer perspective. What is shown is different generation of employees working together, but each with their own mindset of saving and retirement planning. For example, a younger lot, most of the time for them, cash is king. and they would rather enjoy the present than saving for future. Hence, perceived value of retirement benefit is quite low. Just opposite, for a middle-aged person, retirement saving or a sustainable standard of living post-retirement becomes one of the priority and critical. Whereas from an employer perspective, we have seen what they look for is minimum administrative burden and fiduciary responsibility when they look forward to implement or even evaluate any retirement program in their company. They would always like to play conservative without any risk on investment for their employees, for sure. Employers also believe that higher and better the employee engagement is, higher is the success of any such plans. They're also conscious of the fact that each age group have different priorities and their attitude differs accordingly. Hence, taking this journey does become a challenge at times. If you see on the right side of the slide, what we see is employees' priorities when they choose or pick saving retirement plans. What they look for is flexibility, simplicity, higher returns, and overall holistic approach to financial wellness. And not just sticking to one kind of a product or investment. This is based on our own experience when we go to corporates and discuss with the stakeholders on retirement planning. And this is what we hear back from them. Next slide, please. So what will work well? How can employer help? What challenges they face? So let's talk about that. From India, today from India pension perspective, organizations offer primarily superannuation and NPS. Some offer either one of them or both. However, now more and more companies are moving towards NPS. Though we have seen NPS is steadily becoming popular in corporate model, the take-up rate still remains a challenge. Chairman sir also emphasized on same a while back. What we feel, the reason being, it's a voluntary pension program, as we all know, so engaging employees could be challenging. Topics related to financial wellness does not always excite all age groups. So we did speak about this in earlier slide as well. We have also seen just an education session on retirement planning for employees does not prove to be very effective always. So the question is, what makes a difference, right? Based on our own experience, we feel effective communication and personalized approach has a positive effect and result in higher engagement. We all agree today, NPS is a product with some real appealing features. A lot of effort is going in to make it more and more attractive. However, it needs to be communicated well to employees for desired results. Next slide, please. So let's talk a little bit more about the challenges for both stakeholders. Here we are referring to employer and employee. To start with employer, for most of the MNCs, global buy-in is imperative, because before they launch any such plan locally. We have seen global leadership would like to get convinced before local teams takes over. This process at times is time consuming, and to the extent that the decision itself gets deferred for a later stage. Today, many organizations are dependent on a third party for their payroll activities. Hence, third party payroll is another factor or challenge for employers. As you know, many companies use third party for payroll activity. Their system needs to be ready to include NPS as one of the component. Any delay at their end would further delay the entire launch. Employee engagement, the third factor we feel is that employee engagement and internal operational support are equally important tick in the box to decide for any such implementation. Whereas from employee perspective, the challenge is today people are at different level of well-being, and their response to company initiatives are very different. I would still be attracted to iPhone, and retirement saving could take a back seat. So priorities are different. Another common issue, employees are unsure when to start saving, how much to save, what is the ideal time. They sometimes do have the intent to save, but when is undecided. And rather, decision to invest gets deferred every time. So is it fair to say lack of inadequate financial literacy is a big challenge today? I guess yes. We also feel right balance between employee expenses and savings is another issue employees face. And this imbalance would further result in no or inadequate retirement planning. Next slide, please. So this is the final slide on the, and an important slide rather. What ensures success for NPS program in any organization? Take-up rate is the proof of the pudding. Hence, effective and personalized employee communication does make a difference to increase the success percentage. If employees relate themselves to the concept of retirement planning, they will opt in for the program. Right partner for successful implementation is equally important. Here I'm referring to, for example, a POP. An efficient POP would ensure smooth and timely account opening and grievance handling. As we all know today, a satisfied employee would always speak high about the program to more and more employees. It spreads with the word of mouth as well. To ensure a successful NPS program, a company should ensure regular engagement with their employees and not to treat entire implementation as one-time assignment. This is an ongoing process and needs to be carried over throughout the year to ensure high and high take-up rate. So it's important to understand the intention and action gap, as we spoke in earlier slide. Can we use an opt-out option instead of opt-in? Will that work? Maybe good try. Finally, we also feel the company leadership should lead by example. They should be convinced with the program, enrolled in the program, and further convince employees of the relevance of the retirement planning. It is a voluntary program, no doubt, but I'm sure that if more and more people are convinced, a portion of employee population is also convinced, it actually spread to the entire population. That brings end to our session, and many thanks for your patient hearing.
Thank you so much, Ms. Preeti and Mr. Sunil. Thanks for giving the detailed benefits of this NPS, including the personalized approach and good communication. It is very true that mass awareness among corporate is highly required. Thank you so much. With this, I would like to call upon Mr. Monu Phukon, General Manager, PFRDA, to give a presentation on NPS. Mr. Phukon.
Hey, good afternoon. I'll just take you an overview, a brief overview of the NPS scheme and its benefits. Firstly, just to start with, NPS is a personal or an individual pension account. And what I have written is a PRAN, unique PRAN. It's the meaning that it's a permanent retirement account number, which is unique to an individual, and it remains constant or same throughout a person's employment or till the date of maturity at 60 years of age. So even if a person is changing his employment or not, the pension account remains constant or and permanent, and it can be transferred from employer across employer employments and across geographies. NPS is one of the lowest cost pension scheme. It's not only in India, it's a global low-cost product globally also. In fact, total cost comes to around 0.02 to 0.03% in over a period of 30-40 years. There are a lot of flexible choices that is being offered in the system, wherein a subscriber has choices of the fund manager, asset allocations, which I'll talk about in the later part of the slides. Returns has been delivered by over the period of 12 years with the fund managers, which are very attractive and competitive in the sense that as compared to the other investment style savings products that are there in the market, it's very tax efficient. There are a lot of tax benefits on contributions. Accumulations are tax free, and on maturity also, it is almost tax free. So which will Marin Kamdin will be covering up. And when I talk about transparency and online, it's that the entire system is very transparent in the sense that the amount that has been contributed, it has been monitored, it can be reflected, it's reflected in the statement of account, the values can be seen, on a daily basis. We have different methods of accessing it. There are various modes of operating the account online and offline. And over and above, it's regulated by PFRDA in the sense that we register all the entities that are there in the system. We give the investment guidelines. We monitor and supervise all the entities that are working on the within the system so that it functions smoothly and the subscriber is getting the desired level of services. So when we talk about NPS or a pension scheme, the individual pension scheme, we have a nomenclature of a tier one and a tier two. The tier one is basically the pension account, which has all the tax benefits. There are certain restrictions on withdrawals. And for opening that account, we require a minimum of 500 rupees. And the yearly contributions that is being mandated is 1000 rupees. And there's no limit on the number of contributions or the amount of contributions that can be made to the pension account. On the other hand, the tier two is an optional account, which can be only opened when if you have the pension account or the tier one account. It is freely withdrawable. And to open an account, you require only 1000 rupees and the minimum contribution is 250 rupees. And there is also no upper limit on the number of contributions or in the amount of contribution. The only thing is that it can be operated as a running account without any restrictions on withdrawal. And as I've told you, there are no tax benefits, but certain tax benefits are available only for central government employees on their contributions. For joining the scheme, we have to only put two conditions. Basically, it's open to all citizens of India who are aged between 18 to 65 years of age. And certain know your customer formalities have to be complied with. And it can be opened online through Aadhaar, through PAN. And it can be opened through our physical mode, that is by filling up an application and visiting our distribution channels, which are points of presence as in our nomenclature, which are mostly banks and non-banking financial institutions. After opening the account, the contributions flows, the contributions can be made by the subscriber alone. And if he has been attached to an employer and the employer has also given an option, there is an option of for the employer to also contribute. It is not necessary that both the employer and the employee should contribute. It is either of them can contribute. And if the employer agrees to contribute, the proportion of contribution between the employer and the employee can be equal or unequal. So the flexibility has also been built in regarding the contributions amount that flows from the employer, either from the employer or the employee, or in equal or unequal contributions. So once this contribution has been deducted or been remitted through our bankers, it reaches the fund manager, that's a pension fund, who invests those contributions as per the investment guidelines. And at the end of the day, they declare the net asset value of the schemes or the asset means the asset chosen as per the subscriber. So each asset class will have a net asset value and each fund manager will declare that net asset value at the end of the day. So the contributions that has been received by the fund manager is being converted by in the form of units on the net asset value at the end of the day by the record keeper. So these units are then credited to the individual pension account of the individual in the PAN account and reflected in units. So the value of the contributions that is being accruing in the pension account is reflected in units, and the value can be determined by multiplying those units by the current net asset value of the scheme that has been opted for. Exit as is the maturity that is in the scheme. So we say that the normal exit is the superannuation age or 60 years of age. If the superannuation ages of an employer is lower than 60, we consider it as a normal exit. So the normal exit happens on superannuation, wherein 60% of the accumulated corpus is paid to the subscriber or the employee in lump sum, and only 40% is required to be annuitized. Annuitized meaning that it flows to a life insurance company wherein the subscriber has to choose an annuity plan to derive the pension. And if the corpus is less than or equal to 2 lakhs, the entire amount is paid directly or in lump sum to the subscriber. Premature exit we allow after only 10 years. If the customer or the subscriber has joined lately, then we don't insist on the locking period of 10 years. If the customer has joined after 50 years of age, he can be withdrawn. That this it's not applicable. But normally, in a premature kind of an exit, what we say that 80% of the corpus should flow to the insurance company to buy an annuity plan so that he derives a pension out of it. And only 20% of the corpus is being paid as a lump sum to the bank account of the subscriber. In case the corpus is less or equal to 1 lakh, the entire amount is paid in full. And in case of unfortunate death of the subscriber, the 100% of the corpus that is outstanding in the pension account is being paid to the nominee or the legal heirs. So on maturity, as I told you that 40% minimum 40% has to be utilized to buy an annuity plan from an insurance company. We have empaneled 12 leading insurance companies to which provides the annuity plans to choose from. There are almost broad based 7 variants of the plan. And as you've seen, we have all the leading insurance companies, LIC, SBI, HDFC, ICICI, Star Union, DHE, India First, Canara, HSBC, OBC, Kotak Life, Max Life, Edelweiss Tokyo, Tata AIA Life, and Bajaj Alliance. So these 12 annuity service providers have different plans. As I, there are 7 variants of it, and the annuity rates differ from each insurance company to each insurance company, and as per the plan that is being selected. Choices, flexible choices to start with. First, we offer the choice of a record keeper. In fact, we have 2 record keepers, and the distribution channel decides or has a tie up with one of the record keepers. The service levels are standardized. But the only differentiating factor is that in the cost that these 2 record keepers have. Apart from this, the fund manager choice has to be exercised next. In fact, we have 7 fund managers which have a track record, which are registered by us, and they have professional expertise of fund management. They are SBI, LIC, UTI, ICICI, HDFC, Kotak, and Aditya Birla. So what happens is that these professional fund managers manage the contributions and selections can be made by the subscriber. And once the selection is also made, it doesn't remain constant during the entire period. The choices of the fund manager can be changed once in a year. Next comes the contributions, how the contributions will be allocated among the different asset classes. So based on subscribers' choice, we offer 4 asset classes, that is equity, corporate bonds, government securities, and alternate assets. Based on the risk appetite, the subscriber can make an active choice of what percentage should go to equity. We allow maximum 75%. And corporate bonds and government securities, we allow 100%. And to alternate assets, we only allow 5%. So the entire contributions can be distributed amongst these 4 asset classes. And these choices also can be changed twice in a year. A subscriber not willing to exercise an active choice has also can go in for a default life cycle fund. Where what is meant by life cycle fund is that the proportion between the 3 asset classes, equity, corporate bonds, and government securities, is predetermined till the age of 35. So we have a life cycle fund 75, life cycle 50, and 25. It's nothing but the level of equity exposure that is there into this fund. 75% equity exposure in the life cycle fund 70, which we call it is an aggressive fund. Life cycle 50 is a moderate fund where equity exposure is 50%, and life cycle 25 is a conservative fund wherein the equity exposure is 25%. What happens is that up to the age of 35, this proportion remains constant and it goes on decreasing every year. So in an aggressive or a life cycle 75, it gets reduced, equity exposure gets reduced at the rate of 4%, the moderate one as the 2% and 1%, and the debt component goes on increasing. So what happens at the age of 55, the aggressive fund has a equity exposure of 15%, which remains constant till the age of 60 years till maturity. The moderate fund has an equity exposure of 10% reduced to 10% by 55 years, and the conservative one goes to around 5% at the age of 55. as has been told that we have been, fund managers were able to deliver competitive returns, generating competitive returns on the schemes. So equity has been, this is the average return, CAGR returns, which has been average of all the 7 fund managers. So equity has delivered 11.97% over the last 11 years. Corporate bonds, 10.23. Government securities, 10.09. And these two schemes, central government schemes and the state government schemes, are a composite scheme wherein 50% exposure to equity is there, around 30% corporate bonds and 50% government securities. So here also, this has been able to deliver, these two schemes has been deliver more than 10.10% and 10.02% over a period of 12 and 11 years. As of 23rd, the total corpus being supervised or regulated by PFRDA is more than 5,58,60,000, nearing our 5,60,000 crores, of which 4,60,000 crores belongs to the government sector. Around 80,000 crores belongs to the non-government sector, the corporate and the all-citizen model. These are voluntary employees or individuals who have joined the NPS on their own. And the government sponsored schemes around 20,000 crores. The number of subscribers is more than 4 crores, of which 72 lakhs are from the government sector, around 26 lakhs are from the non-government sector, and the rest around 3 crores is from the government sponsored schemes of Atal Pension Yojana and NPS Lite. The transparency and accessibility, as I've told you earlier, this is the feature we allow. We have created, the account can be accessed through a web login. We have developed a mobile app. According to the record keeper, there are the apps are being available on the Google Play Store and on the Apple iStore, also Apple Store, in both the platforms and iOS and Android. And on the web login also, this is available. So a person having the pension account can log into his account, do transactions, get his statements downloaded, contribute, change his fund managers, change the asset allocation, that we allow twice in a year. So everything can be done online at his online through sitting at home or an office through digital means. Lastly, I'll talk about what the grievance redressal mechanism that has been set up by the regulator so that subscribers are not getting aggrieved by the services. We have set up service standards for all the intermediaries, and if any grievances arises out of the service delivery, we have set up the mechanism to redress those. The first level is the intermediary or the entity that against whom the services are pending or not satisfied. So if that is not resolved, we have an escalation matrix of to the trust. Then after that, we have the ombudsman, then the authority itself. And if it's the resolution provided by the authority is also not satisfactory to the subscriber, he can move to the securities tribunal. But this has never been the experience so far. So thank you. Thank you. Over to Mr. Deva. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Phukan, for giving a detailed presentation on NPS and elaborating practically how this NPS works in the background. This is really helpful for all the corporates. Thank you, Mr. Phukan. Now I would request Ms. Behrouz Kamdin, partner Deloitte Haskin & Sells LLP, to give the taxation implication due to the revision of Section 17(2) and recent budget announcements. Here to you, Ms. Kamdin.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Gupta. Thank you, Mr. Bandyopadhyay, for giving us this opportunity to discuss income tax on NPS. Thank you, Mr. Grewal. And hello, Priti and Sunil. So when we discuss any investment opportunities, we always look at the return on investments. And when we look at the return on investments, we always look at net of tax return on investments. So what are my return on investments? Can be taken in gross basis because the rate of tax is different for every individual. And in India, we have a slab rate of taxation. Therefore, we have to look at what is my tax impact to see what my return on investment is. So today we are going to be discussing the tax incentives on investments in NPS and what are the changes which was made by the Finance Act of 2020. So today the economic survey has been released and we're expecting the budget to be released on 1st of February. So there could be certain changes which may happen. and we can have a discussion on that subsequently. So the survey today, which was released, is very appropriate. And there was one statement made, which I think really applies to NPS. Though it was made in a context of our economy, I think it still is very applicable to us over here in this. And it says to the effect that doing the right thing at the right time is the rope which binds wealth, making it boundless. So if we start early in life, and that's what I think Mr. Bandyopadhyay has mentioned, and including Priti has mentioned, that we need to start early in life to save for our retirement benefits. And if we do that early in life, then we really can get a proper corpus and a proper pension that we require at the time when we are retiring. So when you look at the tax incentives, and before I come to tax incentives, there are some key, very good nuances of NPS, which I just wanted to highlight. Though Mono has spoken about it, Mr. Bandyopadhyay has spoken about it, but I thought maybe it's because it's something which I've gone through, and therefore I thought it was very relevant for an individual who's going to apply for an NPS. The first very key thing was portability. When I had joined an organization after qualifying as a chartered accountant, we also had superannuation fund. And I made contributions immediately as I joined to say I will be contributing to it. So it was not me, the employer would contribute. But it's always part of CTC. So we are getting a lesser CTC. And the contribution was made. I left that organization after working for 8 years. It was not that I was going to join any other organization. I just left because I wanted to take a sabbatical. And since the clause in that superannuation fund said that you were entitled to pension only if you work for 10 years. So I did not get my pension. I did not get the contributions and it just lapsed. NPS has a very good feature. In such cases, if you leave, the account stays with the individual employee. It is not, though it is linked to the employer, it's the account of the individual. And therefore, when I leave an organization, the account stays with me. I get the money on retirement. So I don't lose my money. And that is a very good feature of NPS. The second good feature of NPS is basically, which Mr. Bandyopadhyay did speak about, between defined benefit plan and defined contribution plan. Of course, defined benefit plan is favorable if I'm not making any contributions or if the employer is not contributing anything. And I get a fixed lump sum amount for my life. But that fixed lump sum amount is good because it's 50% of last drawn salary when I'm retiring. But if I live for 20 years post-retirement, then that amount is not material, it's minuscule. So if you've worked for some years and you know after some years if you're going to retire, the amount which I get as my fixed benefit plan is not at all feasible to me. But if I do an NPS, what gets fixed is only the 40% on maturity. The 60% is received by me. So when I receive 60% of the NPS on retirement, I can invest in other securities, which can be, you know, taking into account the inflation which is prevailing. So my fixed component comes out of only 40%. So the annuity or the pension comes out of only 40% of the corpus. So it's a blend of both the defined benefit plan and the defined contribution plan. So it's actually a blend of both the schemes which are there. And I think that's an advantage which is there. The third advantage which I felt was of government securities. The return on government securities which the NPS has given is really good. If you compare that with another investment, for retirement benefits, it doesn't come comparable to it. And government securities are most secure today. If anything, which is most secure today is the government securities. So if I'm getting such a good return on government securities, that's the biggest advantage for me. And it's a risk-free return which I'm getting because it's government of India securities. So these are three things which I thought from NPS perspective, which was very relevant. So we go to the next slide. So the tax incentives on an investment. So whenever we look at retirement benefits or an investment, which is long-term, say 20 years, 30 years time period, we try to see what are the tax advantages of an employer contributing to the scheme, an employer getting a deduction for the contribution that it makes, the employee contributing to the scheme. Earlier years, government used to incentivize savings. They would say that an employee, if they contribute to a PF or a PPF, or an NPS, you will get a tax benefit. And the tax benefit was good enough. So that was an incentive which government was giving. So whenever we make investments, look at the tax implications of the employee contributing to the scheme, the annual accretion to the employee account. Every year we are getting some accretion. It's either fixed like in PF or PPF, like an interest component is given. So it's a fixed, or like an NPS is not fixed, it's variable depending on the market and depending on the investment allocation that has been done. So this annual accretion, which you look at it, it's a return on my investment. What is the tax component of it? And then on withdrawal, is it going to be taxable? So if I put a fixed deposit with a bank and I withdraw the fixed deposit, the principal is not taxable. Similarly, if I'm making an investment in PPF and I withdraw the PPF, the principal is not taxable. So when I look at it as an investment, I also look at what is the taxation on withdrawal from that investment of the corpus which comes at the end of retirement. So these are all the four components which any person should look at whenever you're doing an investment. The next slide, Milind, please. So now we come to the taxation of NPS. The first is when the employee contributes. And NPS has this very good feature, like I mentioned earlier, it is not only an employee who can contribute, but also an individual. Professionals like us who are not employees, we can also contribute. Persons who are not working, they can also contribute. So you have employees' contribution and individual contribution to the scheme. There's section 80CCD, which provides for deductions. And that says that an individual, when you're contributing, you can get deduction of up to 20% of your gross. And in case of employees, you get 10% of your salary and dearance allowance. They've kept a lower rate of 10% because employer's contribution is separately allowed as a deduction. So therefore, they say 10% of salary and dearance allowance, what you contribute as an employee, you get as a deduction. And the deduction limit is 1,50,000. So within the overall limit of 1,50,000, you get deduction of 80CCD1. And this is basically covering, also includes the overall limit of 80C, which is like PF, insurance, PPF, the annuities that you take, 80CCC. All of that has an aggregate limit of 1,50,000. So it all comes within this aggregate limit of 1,50,000. However, NPS has this very unique feature, and this is the tax incentive which government has provided. Because it's a long-term investment that you're making, it is additionally 50,000 rupees you'll get as a deduction under 80CCD1B. So this is over and above 1,50,000. So if you've exhausted your 1,50,000 limit, you can still get 50,000 if you're contributing to that amount. Up to 50,000 additional deduction is allowed for 80CCD. Now, if you're in the highest slab bracket, say 30% plus surcharge and says 35% of 50,000 is something which you immediately get as a tax benefit and you're paying lower taxes. So if you look at your return on investments, you should take that net tax investment and then see what your return is. And that would be much higher than what has been already disclosed by Mono. Now we come. So earlier, like I mentioned, the government used to incentivize savings and also contributions to such retirement plans. So if you're under normal rate of tax, which you follow, which is like 10, 20, 30% of tax rates, you get a deduction on 80CCD. However, if you offer a lower rate of tax, which the government has recently introduced, which is section 115BAC, and if you're under lower rate of tax, you don't get any deductions. So you don't get deductions for PF, you don't get deductions for PF, you don't get deductions for contribution to NPS. But your rate of tax is lower. So this is only in those cases when we made an analysis to say that who benefits out of lower rate of tax. It's generally people in the lower income slabs who are benefiting by it. So a person who doesn't have income to invest, he should not be forced to invest or not be forced to do savings just to get tax advantage. That was the thinking. And maybe if you're going for a lower rate of tax, incentives for savings should not be a criteria for tax rates. That's the thinking of the government. So no deductions allowed if you offer a lower rate of tax. Now, when you come to contributions made by the employer to the fund, employer's contribution is fully taxable salary for the employee under Section 17(1) itself. So it is salary for the employee and fully taxable. They have now introduced in the Finance Act 2020 to say that whatever employer's contribution is made will also be taken to come to arrive at a limit of 7,50,000. So we will discuss this a little later to say that what was the change made by the Finance Act. But to understand it presently, employer's contribution is taxable as salary. However, you get a full deduction for that under 80CCD, subject to the limits which they have prescribed. So for an employee, general corporates, 10% of basic salary plus dearance allowance. You get a deduction under 80CCD for employer's contribution. This is employer's contribution. And in case of central government employees, it's 14%. Because central government does contribute up to 14%. So the full 14% is allowed as a deduction. In case of other than central government employers, 10% of the basic is allowed as a deduction. So if an employer contributes more than 10% of the basic plus DA, then that amount gets charged to tax as salary. Even if the employee were to opt for a lower rate of tax under the Section 115 BAC, the employer's contribution, he'll still get a deduction under 80CCD. So employer's contribution, if you look at net-net, is not taxable. First, it gets taxed, and then you get a deduction for it. There's no monetary limit for an employer contribution. Like we had a limit of 1,50,000. There's no such monetary limit when I'm claiming a deduction for an employer's contribution. So the entire employer's contribution gets taxed as salary, and you get a deduction for it under 80CCD. So net-net is not taxed. But it should be within those percentage limits which have been mentioned. Annual accretion to NPS account. The annual accretion is basically by way of the change in the net asset value of the fund. It is not taxable. Presently, it is not taxable. However, they have made an amendment with the Finance Act 2020 to say that any annual accretion which relates to the excess of the employer's contribution to superannuation fund, pension fund and provident fund, on that excess, whatever is the income, that should be taxable for the current year. So this change has happened by the Finance Act 2020 and is applicable for the current financial year, April 20 to March 21 onwards. So we will discuss this a little later when we speak about the Finance Act changes. Withdrawal from the fund. As I explained earlier, the withdrawal, 60% of the withdrawal out, and that 60% withdrawal is not taxable. There's a specific section which says under section 10-12A, which says that 60% of the withdrawal is exempt from tax. 40% has mandatory to be taken for acquiring an annuity. Even that 40% is not taxable. So basically, if you look at it on withdrawal, the entire amount is not taxable. However, when you buy an annuity, there are seven or eight different products of annuity which are there. But whatever annuity you receive will be taxable. So pay to purchase an annuity is presently not taken as a deduction because there are different schemes. So depending on the purpose of what an annuity is taken, whether you want to take the purchase price back on maturity or on death of the annuitant, or it goes to his nominee, or you don't want to take a purchase price, and accordingly you get a higher annuity. But whatever annuity you receive today is fully taxable. So that is something which I think the government should look at. Partial withdrawal from the fund during the previous year. PFRDA allows partial withdrawal in special circumstances. And so the tax authorities have actually, the law says that 25% of the amount withdrawn, 25% of the contribution made by the employee is not taxable. So if your withdrawal is within this 25% of the contribution made by the employee, it is not taxable. If it exceeds the 25% of the contribution made by the employee, that amount is taxable on partial withdrawal. The only problem here is they use the word employee and not individual. So the question comes is, if an individual were to withdraw, like if I as a professional have an account, and I as a professional has an individual account, not an employer-employee account, and if I withdraw, then the whole amount is taxable. Even though my withdrawal is for medical exigencies or some exigencies in the family, still the amount is taxable. So maybe government should look at this also to say that all individuals should get this benefit. Contribution tier 2 account. Mono has discussed what is tier 1 and tier 2 account. Tier 2 account is very similar to a mutual fund. So how mutual funds are taxed, tier 2 accounts are generally taxed in that manner. Tier 2, they have only provided one brief here to say that central government employees, when they contribute to tier 2 accounts, and that tier 2 account is held for 3 years, minimum 3 year period, then you can get a deduction under ATC. And this is within the overall limit of 1,50,000 for tier 2. It's within the overall limit of 1,50,000. This benefit presently is available only to government and to no one else. And you have to hold that account for at least 3 years to be eligible to claim the deduction under ATC. Next slide. So now we come to the Finance Act 2020. Like we said, an employer's contribution, which is done by the employer to a superannuation fund. Earlier, we had this clause 17.2.7, which says that an employer's contribution to superannuation fund is taxable in the hands of the employee if it exceeds 1,50,000 rupees. So up to 1,50,000 rupees, if an employer were to contribute to Supernish Fund, it was not taxable. It was clearly not taxable. And then when you withdraw from the Supernish Fund, you had Section 1013, which provided certain exemptions. So what was happening? Really, 1,50,000 rupees. Finance Act has amended this. Now, when you look at the employer's contribution to recognized provident fund, employers can be recognized provident fund up to 12% of the salary and DA is not taxable. If it exceeds 12%, then it is taxable. So generally, employers would not exceed that amount of 12%. It was within the limits which were prescribed. And these limits have been given in the Act and in Schedule 4th Schedule of the Income Tax Act. So employers' contribution was not taxable earlier when it was done to a recognized provident fund. So fund, we had this benefit of up to 1,50,000, it was not taxable. So the Finance Act has now amended this. They said employers' contribution to recognized provident fund, to NPS, to superannuation fund will be taxable if it exceeds 7,50,000 rupees. So they have aggregated all of the contributions together and they have said that if that aggregate contribution were to exceed 7,50,000 rupees, then the excess will be taxable. And they have also made one more change to say that the annual accretion on this excess, the excess over 7,50,000 would be taxable. Now the question comes in case of annual accretion. How do we do this annual accretion? They have not yet prescribed the rules and they are going to prescribe it. It has been very clearly mentioned that the manner of computing will be prescribed. So we are awaiting the rules since the amendment is applicable from the current year. We expect the rules to come out by March 2021. And we expect some sort of a hierarchy as to what will be taxed first. What is the amount? The excess will be attributed to what? Will it be attributed to superannuation fund first? Or will it be attributed to recognized provident fund? Or will it be attributed to NPS? See, NPS is already taxed under 17.1. It is again being aggregated year to be taxed again under 17.2 as perquisite. It appears to be like a double taxation. However, we have to see that we're getting a deduction at ATCCD1 also. And then the annual accretion is getting taxed. So we need to wait and see what the rules are prescribed. But this is something which every organization will have to look at to see that if there's any excess of above 7,50,000, have you taxed it for the current year? And if there's any annual accretion which happens on this excess amount for the year, then that also is taxable. The next slide, please. These are some of the COVID reliefs. We just a key few of them which have happened. Employee contribution was reduced because of the lockdown and so that more money is available to people from 12 to 10%. This is only for 3 months period. Non-refundable advance was given to EPF members. And the question comes is basically that if will it be taxable? It's only an advance which has been given, but it's not repaid. And would it be taxable? We believe that this is not on closure of the EPF account. And therefore, it should not be taxable. The taxation will only come if you're less than 5 years. If you're more than 5 years, anyway, EPF is not taxable. So only in those cases, you'll have to look at it. Partial withdrawal to fulfill financial needs. PFRDA also has allowed this partial withdrawal. And as we discussed earlier, in case of employees, if it's within the 25% of the contribution, it should not be taxable. Anything above the 25% of the employee contribution will get taxed. In case of individuals, the entire amount should get taxed. Investments for claiming deductions under Chapter 6A. So for the financial year 19-20, whenever I make investments, I have to do the investments by 31st March 2020 for me to claim a deduction under ATC, ATCCD. Because of the pandemic and the lockdown, the government has extended timeline to make investments up to July 2020. So I had additional 4 months. I have invested after the year end, but I'm getting a relief in the earlier year. So I'm getting a refund earlier than what my investments have been made. And this is a very good feature which the government has actually given, that I can invest later post the financial year end and still get a relief in the earlier year. And this is also very crucial because in subsequent year, if you're going at a lower rate of tax, you may not be able to claim this deduction. So though you've made an investment, you can get in the earlier year where you're under normal rate of tax. Extension of timeline filing return of income for the financial 19-20. The timeline has again been extended. It's not 30th November. It's got extended till 10th of January 2021 for individuals or non-corporates. And for corporates and those having tax audits, it's till 12th February 2021. So they have extended timelines. And this is some relief which government has given considering the lockdown. Thank you. And if anyone has any questions, we would be pleased to answer it. Over to you, Mr. Manish Gupta. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Kambhir, for giving a detailed tax implication and making us corporate understand the benefit of using NPS and the withdrawal scheme and the benefits for employees and employers. With new tax regime coming from 1st of Feb, we get to see the more tax benefits or the implication for this scheme. Thank you, Mr. Kamte. Herein, I open the session for question and answer. Before going for this open QA session, from as a corporate, I would like to understand that this NPS is a very flexible system. Just like mobile portability, employees can port the company and they have the benefit extension scheme. That is really wonderful for all the employees and the employers as well. A simple question from my side is, from a corporate side, maybe Ms. Preeti or Mr. Nair could elaborate the difference in the benefits as compared to the NPS vis-a-vis the insurance schemes floated by normal insurance companies. How does a corporate compare the insurance schemes given by insurance companies and this NPS?
Yeah, so the schemes are very clearly different. NPS, the entire architecture is extremely transparent. You know what money you're putting in, you know where it's getting invested, okay? You know the returns there, you know what is the fee charged by the various stakeholders. So it's very, very clear on the charge structure, the way your returns are. And it's very, very portable, flexible. I mean, unlike premiums somewhere else, I have complete flexibility. You know, I can just pay a minimum contribution and almost go on a contribution holiday for a big sense and then come back and start putting in more money. So I have complete freedom and flexibility to save for my retirement at a pace, at a quantum that I want. Of course, it is portable also. You can change fund managers, you decide, you can change your asset allocations. Whereas when you're talking about an insurance company, it is all bundled there. Okay, in the sense that you pay a certain amount of money, the insurance company decides on where it gets invested. The returns are pretty much tied to the kind of product you're talking about, which is not the case for NPS. NPS is completely open, flexible, transparent. And I don't want to sort of say more in favor of NPS as compared to insurance product. That's not the intent. But if you just look at it very objectively, feature by feature, that is the advantage of NPS vis-a-vis any insurance product. Happy to get views from others. And of course, the tax element, Bharos would have sort of, I see Bharos smiling. So I think that element I would leave to you to sort of elaborate on.
Just to add to what Preeti just mentioned, Mr. Manish, myself, Preeti, we all come from an insurance background. So let me also let you know that this NPS is actually being projected as one of the most cheapest pension product available in the market. If you compare with any retail insurance product, a pension product, the charge itself is so high. There are certain elements with regard to fund management charges, portfolio allocation charges, mortality charges, that it is even to break even. It actually takes few years time. With that perspective, I think it is actually one of the cheapest pension product. Bharos, you may add to that. I thought I will share that point of view.
Yeah, thanks Preeti and Sunil. Basically what is mentioned is true. I mean, Preeti has covered all of it to say, and from tax perspective, you have an 80CCC section, which is there, which allows you a deduction when you buy an annuity or a pension product from an insurance company. And the limit there is 1,50,000. But that comes within the overall limit of your PF. So 80C, 80CCC, 80CCD, all of that comes within the overall limit of 1,50,000. So if you have PF and you have insurance and you have PPF, then you anyway get exhausted in that 1,50,000 limit. NPS is the only free investment which gets an additional 50,000 rupees, which is not available in case of insurance. So that is an additional benefit that you get. Second thing which is very important is that securities, when I'm making investments, so like a fund manager is buying securities on the market, I have to pay securities transaction tax. Insurance companies have to pay securities transaction tax. And NPS doesn't pay it. and therefore my return will increase, though the amount may not be very material. But every security, if you look at it totally, it will come to some amount. So you don't pay securities transaction tax. That is a very important thing. NPS income is not taxable. That is, there's no withholding of tax when you make payment to an NPS. So all of that gives you a much more higher cash flows which come into NPS then. So there's no withholding tax. So they receive dividends. The companies don't have to withhold tax. So I get a higher cash flow, which I can invest. So that's an added advantage for NPS. There's no securities transaction tax. There's no withholding tax on interest, which NPS gets. All of that adds to my corpus and higher important this idea investing. And of course, an 50,000 tax benefit. Mr. Bandopadhyay may want to add something on that.
Sir, you have made my job pretty easy. Explaining the difficult points. So I can only add that there is a few more benefits, like when NPS contributor ultimately goes for an annuity, he need not pay any GST. But when you are buying an annuity from a life insurance fund, you have to pay 1.8% GST. So that also adds. So these little bits add to that extent. And basically, I want to highlight the investment management. The investment management, mostly in insurance companies, these superannuation funds, they have mark-to-market kind of management also. But whatever we have seen, the returns here are far, far better. Far better than what you have. And mostly the insurance companies, what they do it in a maturity situation. The basic difference is they buy certain securities, whether fixed income securities or equity or whatever it is, they accumulate the income of that fund over a period, and then they declare a return. So obviously, if you look at it, unless you realize that security by selling it in the market, you don't really get the benefit out of it. But here, any capital appreciation gets passed on to the customer. So that way, it is a more dynamic way of managing funds. And as we have seen over the years, we are giving a much, much higher return than normal insurance funds are giving. So these are
the 2 points I thought I'll add. Thank you so much, Mr. Bandopadhyay, Mr. Nahar, and Ms. Priti. We'll open the session for this thing. One question which has come in the chat box is from Mr. Rakesh Nakhani. He says, if after retirement within 2 years, any casualty happens with me and nominee, then what will happen to the amount my kids will be getting? That is first part. And second part he says is, where we can get this NPS scheme? From our bank or only from the web line? So,
the first part is that I only suggest that when somebody is choosing the kind of annuities, as Barros Madam has already pointed out, there are 8-10 kinds of different kinds of annuities. So first we have to understand the kind of annuities that we are buying. The most sold annuities in India is an annuity where annuitant gets payment on regular basis till he or she is alive, and on death of the annuitant, in some cases there is a possibility that it can go to the spouse a similar amount, and on death of the spouse, the entire corpus to which the annuity was purchased goes back to the nominee at that point of time. So that possibility is there. But when you choose your annuity, you have to be careful that you are choosing that kind of annuity if you really wish to give it back to your kids at a later part. So that is what I say. And where you can get the NPS scheme, that is PNP or any other. You can get from all the banks that way. They are our distributors. You can go, you can buy from them. Other ways, we have an online channel, ENPS channel open. So they are sitting at home also, we can do it. And all the possibilities are there.
Thank you, Mr. Bandopadhyay. in case anyone have a question,
refer? I think.
Yeah.
Hello, Mr. Gupta.
Yeah.
Just one point. I think what Mr. Rakesh Nakhani has mentioned is that the annuitant and the nominee both are no longer there.
Maybe,
so
yeah.
That I think would be more legal question. But if Mr. Bandopadhyay can address it, can then person who's not nominated get the amount? Of course, it will of course depend on the insurance company and the annuity policy features and all of that. But
yeah.
Yes.
That's from a legal perspective, say that can a successor, because yeah. both the annuitant and the nominee both are no longer there, then can the kids get the amount? I'm not sure on it, but maybe Mr. Bandopadhyay can look at it, say
yeah,
that if something like
what
this happens, what can be done?
What happens not only in annuity, in all insurance products, normally what happens, if the person is alive, there is a nomination. Suppose both the nominee and the annuitant both die with maybe simultaneously. In that case, what happens? The corpus will go back to the legal heirs. Yes, you have to get a succession certificate, maybe that is required to prove your that you are the legal heir. But it is possible and it is done.
Thank you, sir. I would request the secretariat if some more people are here to ask a question, they can raise hands and you can unmute them and they can raise the question themselves.
Sir, good afternoon. This is Gautam. Mr. Amar B. Singh from Indian Polymer Industries, sir. I just unmute him. Abhi, sir.
Yeah, you are audible. Please go ahead.
Sir, I'm just unmuting Mr. Amar B. Singh. Okay, can you hear me? Can you hear us right now? Ramabir, sir? Sir?
Smaller point, please.
Yes, please.
What is the payment number? 58.
Smaller point?
Please.
80 button? Hello?
Amarpitji, you are audible. Please go ahead.
इसमें आप अभी ठीक करो उसका रेट 6 नंबर में 10.65 करो इसमें ठीक करो बेटा
अमर मिर्ज जी यू आर ऑडिबल प्लीज गो अहेड
बाकी बाकी तो देखना होगा हमारे का सर आई डोंट थिंक
नमिड
आई है डाउन वाली
नमिड आई है डाउन
गौतम जी नॉट ऑडिबल नाउ
Sir, we also have Mr. Naveen Manglani with us and Mr. Puneet Vij. So I'll just unmute Mr. Puneet Vij in case he has a question. Sir, good evening.
I have a question. As an employer, do you need to have, is there any limit number of employees you should have to enroll in the NPS scheme, or I can enroll with even 10 number of employees?
Any number you can enroll with NPS, and you are welcome to join the system. Absolutely no restriction on numbers. Maximum,
right.
Minimum.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Let me check on Mr. Naveen Manglani, sir. Just give me a minute.
Yeah.
Mr. Manglani, good afternoon, sir. Gautam. Can you hear us? Hello?
Gautam, Mr. Naveen is still muted himself.
So we are probably facing some issues with the network. Just give me a minute. I'll just check on Mr. Manglani once again. In the meantime, if anyone has a question, please do let us know. You can just raise your hand. I'll just unmute you. It seems.
Can I just elaborate? Have one more slight observation on this thing. Could Mr. Preeti or maybe anybody else can explain the exit process? How much it is simpler for any employee to exit from this system if you are comparing with the other exit system of any insurance company?
One more thing I have not pointed out, Mr. Gupta, if you permit me, I can add that.
Sure, sir.
At the point of exit also, NPS allows 60% withdrawal, which is tax-free. But if you are in an insurance company managed superannuation fund, only 1/3 of your withdrawal at the point of exit is tax-free. Balance 2/3 is taxable. So that is a big benefit. Given to NPS subscribers. How your question, please? What are you?
I think, sir, that is a question he was asking, right? He was asking about the withdrawal benefit for compared to insurance companies' plans.
And even the ease of getting exit,
Ease of exit, even it will be more in NPS as Madam Vedros started with her own experience that if you are in a particularly company managed superannuation scheme which is managed by insurance companies, they have their certain rules. If you have not fulfilled those many number of years of employment, you may not get anything. Those things are there. And again, shifting your fund from one company to another company, it is possible, but it's not easy because two companies may not have superannuation funds.
Correct.
Same insurance company. So that is not easy. Here, suppose somebody is joining another employer and that employer does not have a NPS scheme with PFRDA, but still that person has the liberty to manage his account as an individual, retail customer. And absolutely no restriction to that.
So you can just tag yourself to your employer and untag yourself whenever you want. So that is the flexibility that you get.
Mr. Bansal, one more question for me. When I have to withdraw on retirement, what is the it takes? Does it take 1 week's time or it takes 5 days or 1 month for me to get my 60% and for me to buy an annuity? What is the process and how long does it take?
I think our ideal turnaround time is T+9. And now even exit also, we have done it on online mode. You can just scan your documents and send it online mode. That way also it can be done. Otherwise, earlier it was all physical processes, but during pandemic also, we felt that customers are having problem doing that. So we have done it online. So T+9, you can take 10 days maybe. Within that, you will get it. And they do the account verification and all that, to which account the money will go. And thereafter, they release that.
So I think Mr. Manish Gupta, I think this answers your question that there's ease of withdrawal.
Is it really fruitful for all the corporates listening at 10 days? It is a very good time for all the corporates. Thank you, sir. Gautam, any other questions from the participants?
No, sir. There are any, sir. No more questions. Please.
Okay. So here with this, I make a formal concluding remarks and vote of thanks. A very good afternoon to all of you. Mr. Supratim Bandhopadhyay, Chairman, PFRDA, Ms. Preeti Chandrasekhar, India Business Leader, Health and Wealth, and Fellow Actuary, Mercer, Mr. Sameer Nair, Senior Consultant, Mercer, Mr. Mono Foucault, General Manager, PFRDA, Ms. Behrouz Kandin, Partner, Deloitte, Haskins & Sells, LLP, and our colleague, Dr. S.P.S. Grewal, Chairman, CII Chandigarh, and all ladies and gentlemen, it is my privilege to be part of the webinar on National Pension Scheme NPS for corporates and be among such distinguished dignitaries in this session. Rightly pointed out by the distinguished guest, NPS is an excellent option for a substantial corpus creation for one's retirement phase. NPS offers various benefits such as flexibility, dual benefit of low cost and power of compounding, tax benefits, safety regulated and monitored. NPS is also simple to operate and open, as the subscriber can open an account with any of the point of presence or through eNPS and get a permanent retirement account number. It is worthwhile to note that while doing my engineering, all of us, we were eager to get a government job just for the benefit of our ease of getting payment and the pension scheme. With this, I would rather suppose that more employability towards the corporate would increase with the benefit of NPS. I would like to convey my personal sincere thanks to Mr. Suprabhat Bandyopadhyay, Chairman PFRDA, for sparing his valuable time and for keynote address and encouraging corporates for this NPS. Thank you, sir. I would like to thank personally Ms. Preeti and Mr. Sunil from Bursar for giving detailed benefits of NPS and creating a mass awareness among the corporates. Thank you, sir. Thank you to Mr. Foucon for giving detailed presentation on NPS and elaborating the practical utility of NPS. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Ms. Kamdeen, for giving detailed tax implications and making us understand the benefits of using NPS. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Gupta.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Have a good weekend.
Hello. Ah, Deepak.